It's essentially impossible to separate God from His Word. If you have faith in the Lord, then you have faith in the power of His Word. If you have love for God, then you have love for His Word. If you fear the Lord, then you have a heart that desires to keep His Word. There's no daylight, in other words, between the Lord's nature and the nature of His Word. Jesus said that if you loved Him, you would do what He commanded. And the only way to know what He commanded is to look at His Word. This is the whole point of Psalm 119, the longest chapter in the Bible. It's a call for you to recognize that if you want to follow the path of the Lord, you have to keep your feet and your eyes and your heart in the path of His Word. You want to follow the footsteps of Christ, you follow the footsteps laid out in His Word, that Jesus ran the course before us, and that course is marked out by His suffering revealed through the Word. Time and time again, Scripture makes the proclamation that for you to know the Lord, you have to know His Word. There's no difference between the two. This is the error of legalism. Legalism doesn't only say that you need to work your way to salvation, that you need to do things God commands so that He loves you, but the heart of legalism is this separation between the saving nature of God and the commands in His Word. The heart of the legalist sees God's Word as outside of himself. Do these things to convince this person to love me in response to this. That's legalism. And the heart error in that is separating the nature of God from the nature of the Word. The theological liberal commits the same error himself. The theological liberal says you don't need to take Scripture seriously because God is more benevolent or more loving or more generous or more like I think God is than His Word is. The real God wouldn't want me to do what His Word says because that's unloving. The real God is different than His Word. It's the same error as legalism, separating God from His Word. At least the atheist is generally consistent. At least the atheist says, I don't believe in the Bible because I don't believe in God. At least they keep them connected. I wish more Christians would have that same logic, just in the opposite direction, that I take God's Word seriously because I take God seriously. What do we have in Israel, circa 875 BC, is a nation of people that do not believe in God, and so they do not believe in God's Word. They've rejected Yahweh and replaced Him with the rain god. And so because of that, they've rejected God's Word and replaced it with holding on to this idea that if you worship Baal long enough, He'll eventually send rain. The Israelites had silenced God's Word because they had no room for God in their own hearts. Because they had disdain towards Yahweh, they separated themselves from Yahweh's prophet. What we looked at last week was in Jerusalem, King Asa was reigning. Godly King Asa was reigning over Judah and Benjamin. But in the other 10 tribes, it was bad news. In the other 10 tribes, they were not seeking Yahweh. In the other 10 tribes, they had rejected the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. They'd moved on from the God of Moses and the God of Joshua and the God of David and the God of Solomon. They were done with that part of their history. In 1 Kings 16, which we looked at last Sunday evening, I called it a clown car of kings. It's just one awful king after another. They keep piling up on top of each other, each one worse than the one before. Some of them reigning for only a few moments or a few days. One of them who literally burned his own house down and forgot to escape. Those are the kind of kings that Israel had. When they rejected worshiping Yahweh and replaced Him with the rain god, they rejected common sense and are now worshiping a myth. They had silenced God's Word. The worst of those kings was King Ahab. We'll look at him the next few weeks. He kind of features prominently in 1 Kings and 2 Kings. Ahab was the worst of the worst. He rode away for a mail order bride, brought her in from another nation, and she brought her gods with her. And all Israel was compelled to worship Baal, the rain god. And it's in this context that Elijah bursts onto the scene here, chapter 17, verse 1. Elijah the Tishbite, who is of the settlers of Gilead, he's on the fringes of Israel. He just bursts into the room where King Ahab is, and that's the same way he bursts into Scripture. We don't get any introduction about Elijah beyond this. We don't know the details of his life. We don't know what provoked him to confront Ahab. He just bursts onto the pages of Scripture. And from here on out, the book of 1 Kings changes. 1 and 2 Kings stops being about kings and starts being about prophets. I'm sure many of you know this, but 1 and 2 Kings were not originally two different books. They were originally one book. They're divided in the English Bible because they were too long for one scroll to contain. So they're split, 1st and 2nd Kings. They're really not about kings, though. From this point forward, they're all about the prophets. It should be called 1st Prophet and 2nd Prophet, Elijah and Elisha. By the time you get into 2 Kings, it's almost like the narrator is done with kings altogether. He sometimes forgets to even tell you their names. The focus of the story becomes the prophets, because the prophets are the ones with the word of God. The prophet had God's word. And so if you want to know what God thinks about something, you turn to his prophets. And the main theme that's holding chapter 17 together is the word of God. We see 5 different times in this chapter statements about the word of the Lord. Verses 2, verses 5, verses 8, verses 16, verse 25, along with another 6 or so allusions to it. The most common refrain in this chapter is that Yahweh spoke. Yahweh's word is true. Yahweh's word is at work. And so I want to give you an outline this morning. 3 functions of God's powerful word. 3 functions of God's powerful word. 3 things that God's word is doing in this chapter. And by extrapolation, 3 things that God's word is doing in the world. You know, God's word never rests. God's word doesn't take a Sabbath. God's word doesn't go home and take a nap. It doesn't take time off. God's word is always active. It is living and active. It's always doing stuff. God's prophets can be in jail, but his word is not chained. His word always accomplishes what it's sent into the world to do. There are no falling words, Samuel says. Every word from God's mouth achieves its accomplished purpose. We see 3 of those purposes in this section this morning. Before we get any further, understand what the role of a prophet was. A prophet is the one with God's word. If you were living during Ahab's life, you had access to some of God's word. By this point in Israelite history, they had the Torah, so they had God's law. They knew how they were supposed to live. They had Judges, and they had Joshua. They had Ruth. They had 1 and 2 Samuel. They had the wisdom literature, Job's, David's Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon. They're all written. So they had some access to God's word, but the prophets weren't written. The minor prophets hadn't been compiled. Most of the major prophets hadn't lived yet. But they knew what God required of them. But that wasn't, in a sense, sufficient for God's nation. If God's people wanted to know, should they make a treaty with this nation? Should they go into this battle? Should they fight or should they retreat? You can't look at Deuteronomy for that. You needed a prophet for that. And that's why they had prophets. Prophets had the word of the Lord. You wanted to know what God thought about this war or that battle, you needed a prophet. And so if God wanted to withhold his word from his people, he merely withheld his prophets from his people. Or when the Israelites turned against God and God's word, they turned against their prophets. It was one and the same. And by the way, that's why today in the church, there are no prophets. There are no prophets today because God is not working through a nation. God is working through his church. God's word is complete and it contains his revelation. God is working through his church, reconciling sinful people to a holy and righteous God through the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so there's no prophets. It's not like there's a nation that needs to know this war or that war. What would God have us do? Because he's not working through a nation. He's working through his word and his church. This is not the case of Israel, though. Israel needed their prophets. And so when they turned against God, they turned against God's prophets. There was a famine of God's word in the land. And this is where we get our context for what God's word is doing. First, God's word confronts the sinner. What's God's word doing in the world? First, it confronts the sinner. Verse 1, Elijah bursts onto the scene. And believe me, once you learn a little bit more about Elijah, you'll know this. He didn't have an appointment this morning. He didn't schedule this appearance with King Ahab. He probably broke the door in and walks right in on him. This is what he declares to wicked King Ahab. As Yahweh, and notice he uses God's covenant name, as Yahweh, the God of Israel lives. Notice a little dig at Ahab here. Elijah declares, Yahweh is Israel's God and he is alive, Ahab. All of Israel refuses to worship him. That doesn't kill him. Listen, if God is true, it doesn't matter if every individual on the earth withholds worship. If every individual on the earth is an atheist, that doesn't kill God. He still lives, and that's Elijah's rebuke to Ahab. God, Yahweh, the Lord of Israel, he's alive, and he says, before whom I stand. Another dig at King Ahab. I'm not standing before earthly royalty. You might think I'm in your throne room standing before you. Ha! I'm standing before Yahweh, the God of Israel. He's the one I'm standing in front of right now, but I'm talking to you, Ahab. Surely there shall be neither dew nor rain all these years except by my word. Peace out through the door, roll the credits, movie over. I mean, that's an introduction right there. No more rain. What do you mean no more rain? It always rains. Nope, not anymore. No more dew. How do you stop the dew? Well, God stops the dew. That's how you stop the dew. Dew always happens. No, not when God says no dew. No dew for you. No more. Notice the ironic use here of Ahab's rebuke. You want to worship the rain god? You want to reject Yahweh for the rain god? Fine. No rain. You want to worship Baal? You don't even get a drop of dew on the ground. That's what God thinks of Baal. Bye. And notice also, he doesn't say it won't rain again until the Lord says so. He says it won't rain again until I say so. Another little reminder here that there's no separation between God and God's word. When the prophet speaks God's word, he's speaking what God says. You can't distinguish between the two. So much so that Elijah could confidently say, you won't get a drop of dew on the ground until I say so. And then he leaves. This, by the way, he did not have a word from the Lord for this either. Verse 2 says, then the word of the Lord. It's in the New American Standard, it says the word of Yahweh came to him. But a better Hebrew way of rendering it would be then the word of the Lord. It's consecutive. Next, the word of the Lord came to him. That should be, you'd think that would be the opposite. Elijah bursts in and says, no more rain for you, and walks out. And you can imagine a moment of nervousness like, okay, God, back me up on this, right? And then the word of the Lord came to him. Whew. What's Elijah doing here? Is he stepping all out on his own here? Well, no, because the book of Deuteronomy gave a curse to Israel and said, if you worship the rain god, you won't get rain. And so Elijah here is acting on what God's word has already revealed. And that's often the case with even God's prophets in the Old Testament. So much of what they say is not new revelation. Most of what the prophets in the Bible say has already been revealed by God through his word. And that's the case here. You want to worship the rain god, you're not going to get any rain. God said that all the way back in Deuteronomy. But notice, this is the first function of the word of God, to confront the sinner. The word of God, much of what it was designed to do is confrontive. The word of God is designed by the Lord, breathed by him to expose sin. It is living and active, sharper than a two-edged sword. It's designed to lay you bare before him. Or as Paul says, it leaves us naked and exposed before the one to whom we must give an account. The word of God exposes your motives. It confronts you in your sin. It opens your eyes to the fact that you are a sinner separated from God. Sin is not just something you do. Sin is who you are, and you can't fix it. You can't unsin yourself. You can't do better and try harder. You are alienated from God. That's what the word of God is used to show you. You come into this world separated by God, and the word of God shows you that. Jeremiah says the word of God is like a hammer. It shatters the hard rock of people's hearts. It's an anvil. It crushes the hardness and the callousness of our hearts. We, through sin, make our heart callous, but the word of God can shatter even that. The word of God is designed to confront people in their sin. It's the law of God that breaks the proud. The arrogant person rises up against God and thinks that they're close to God. Their self-righteousness is what they stand on. The word of God humbles them. The word of God takes their self-righteous legs out from underneath them. The word of God is a hammer that breaks the proud. And that's the right way to use it, by the way. Paul says this in 1 Timothy 1, I believe it's verse 10, that the word of God, when it's used lawfully, is good. It's the tool, lawfully, meaning it's used to confront the sinner in their sin. We live in kind of an effeminate age that likes to be mamby-pamby with this. It refers, you know, we refer to sin as mistakes. We say, oh yeah, the Bible teaches that we've all made mistakes. What kind of language is that? The Bible doesn't teach that we've all made mistakes. That's not the point. Of course you've made mistakes. The Bible teaches that we are all sinners and fall short of God's glory, far short of God's glory. You know, you speak of sin as mistakes, people go through the Bible and they think, oh, you know, I better just try better. I better do gooder. You know, you confront somebody with the Bible and say, listen, the Bible teaches that you are an idolater, that you worship other gods because you esteem yourself and you put your plans before God's plans. That's idolatry. The Bible teaches that you're a murderer because you have hate in your heart for other people, that you by nature are a murderer. The Bible teaches that you're an adulterer because you have lust in your heart for other people. That it makes you an adulterer. The Bible teaches that all of these sins, you know, you lie by nature. You're separated from God. And when you minimize that, you have people who walk away from that and say, oh yeah, the Bible's taught me that I need to do better. I need to clean up my act. The law has shown me that I fall short of God, so I gotta try better. Listen, that's like saying that the 1,000-pound weight you strapped around your neck and jumped in the swimming pool taught you the next time you need to kick harder. You just need to work on your stroke a little bit more to stay at the top of the water with that 1,000-pound weight dragging you down. That's not the point of the weight. It wasn't designed to teach you to kick better. The weight was designed to drown you. It was designed to crush you, to break you. That's what God's law is designed to do. It's designed to confront you in your sin and humble you and break you before God, not to show you to try more, but to show you to die before the Lord and say that I'm a sinner. By nature, I'm separated from you. I'm confronted by your word. That's how Elijah uses it. It's unloving to people. Listen, it's unloving to people to refuse to confront them in their sin. When you confront people in their sin, you use the word of the Lord. You show what God's word says and how it's different than what they believe or how they're living. That's loving. Not when you do it obnoxiously, but you do it lovingly. This is the design of God's word. That's what God's word is doing in the world. It's confronting people in their sin, and I hope you're using it that way. Well, that starts this epic showdown. It's going to go from chapter 17, verse 1, all the way to the end of chapter 22. This becomes the rest of the book of 1 Kings. Who's stronger, God or Ahab? Who's stronger, Yahweh or Baal? Whose word is more powerful, God's prophet or the king? The king is going to put a bounty on Elijah's head. The king is going to give a cash reward, issue a warrant for his arrest, all points bulletin. Somebody find Elijah and bring him back here. And what's the king's logic? Well, Elijah said it won't rain until he says so. So there's a drought, there's a famine. Better get Elijah and torture him until he says so. Just marvel at that logic for a second. Rather than repent, let's torture the word rain out of the prophet. And that becomes Ahab's approach. And this becomes the showdown for the rest of the book of 1 Kings. Who's going to win? Whose word is stronger, Yahweh's or Baal's? And this leads to the second point. Not only does God's word confront the sinner, secondly, God's word nourishes the believer. It nourishes the believer. The word of Yahweh came to Elijah saying, go away from here, turn eastward, hide yourself at the brook Cherith, is how you would say it in modern Hebrew. If you're reading Hebrew, it would be pronounced Korit, but if you were being Israel today, you would pronounce it Cherith. Go to yourself, hide yourself by the brook of Cherith, which is east of the Jordan. This is on the very fringes of Israel now. It's this little tiny brook. There's not even a tourist sign there like, oh, hey, here's the brook of Cherith that Elijah hid. I mean, it's this tiny little thing. It's up in the hills there. If God's going to hide his prophet, he's not going to put him along the Jordan River, although there's more water in the Jordan River than in a tiny brook. If you're hunting down the prophet, I mean, Israel has only one river. You'd look for him there, especially if there's a drought. So God hides Elijah up in the hills next to a brook in total isolation. There's no houses up there. Nobody lives in these hills. If you've been to Israel, you drive in this area, you drive on the highway that runs by this area. Even today, there's nothing up there. There's no houses, there's no huts, there's no mountain men up there. It's just desolate. And that's where Elijah goes to hide. It shall be, Yahweh says in verse 4, that you will drink of the brook. That's how you get water. I've commanded the ravens to provide for you there. I'm sorry, what? The ravens? Could God have picked a more miserly creature than a raven? Have you guys seen ravens? I see them outside my office all the time. They congregate in the McDonald's parking lot. Make your own deductions about that, by the way. And one of them will grab a McDonald's fry wrapper and fly across the street and seek refuge in the church parking lot as if we're a sanctuary for ravens. And the other murder of ravens will follow them. It becomes this epic battle royale in the parking lot over a little sliver of a fry wrapper. It was a wrapper soaked in oil, I guess. And it's just like an epic raven fight. What in the world is going on out there? Maybe I should focus more on my studies instead of the ravens. But every day they're battling out there. Ravens don't share. It's not in a raven's nature to share. Unless God tells the raven to share. And that's where a raven is different than us. If God tells us something, our inclination is to do the opposite. But if God tells a raven something, a raven shrugs. Okay, I'll share. And that's what happens. Elijah does according to the word of Yahweh, verse 5. He went and lived by the brook Cherith, which is in the east of the Jordan. The ravens brought him bread and meat in the morning. What kind of meat does a raven bring? Don't ask, don't tell, I think. And by the way, a little side note here, both the bread and the meat the raven is bringing would by definition in Israel be unclean. Not like FDA unclean, although certainly by FDA standards unclean, but unclean by Levitical standards. A raven is an unclean bird. If you touch a raven in the Old Testament, you are unclean for a period of time until you make the appropriate sacrifice and the appropriate washings. Any food a raven touched would be unclean, but now Yahweh is having his prophet be fed by unclean creatures. And he's drinking from the brook. And he does this every day, verse 6 says. Bread and meat in the morning and bread and meat in the evening, and he would drink from the brook. Notice that God did not provide for him a grocery store. God did not provide for him a Costco membership here. He does not get to store up enough food. He is dependent upon the truth of God's word every morning and every evening, or he will die. And this becomes a metaphor for the Christian life. This is how we should approach God's word. We should be dependent upon God's feeding of us through his word. Listen, we're sheep, and sheep like to eat. And sheep eat. God's sheep eat from God's word every day. I'm not allegorizing the text here as if the real spiritual meaning is that Elijah depended upon God's word every day. It's a literal meaning here. Elijah was literally dependent upon the word of the Lord. That's why the text says, according to the word of the Lord. This is God's word that is doing this, verse 5 says, according to Yahweh's word. Elijah's dependent upon the truthfulness of Yahweh's word every single day. And so should you be as well. I pity the person who doesn't open God's word during the week, that opens it on Sunday and opens it again next Sunday. I mean, that's a spiritually malnourished sheep. That's a sheep on the verge of death. That's a sheep eating the diet of a raven who's you know, picking up a scrap here or there. That's not how you're supposed to feed. Daily dependence upon God and God's word. Reading your Bible daily. That's how God feeds us. You can't store it up for the winter. You're not a bear. You can't read enough of Scripture. You know, you go through your New Year's plan and you crank out a whole bunch of the Bible in January and so, hey, I'm done. You know, guys, I had a really awesome quiet time 3 months ago, so I don't need to read the Bible now for another few months. I'm living off of that. That's not the way God designed you to work. You need God's word every day. Every day. Well, that's Elijah dependent every day, but it happens after a while, verse 7. That the brook dried up because there was no rain in the land. And that phrase, it happened, in the Hebrew there, it literally means in the presence of Elijah. In other words, Elijah is watching the brook dry up. Every day he's going out to the brook and it is growing smaller and narrower and shallower, and it's finally just a trickle. Day after day it gets smaller, and eventually it stops flowing altogether. And there's no word of the Lord yet, and the water is done. You know, in a drought, there's no rain, and so the crops don't grow. You can't eat grass. There's no water. The animals die because they can't eat the grass and they have no water to drink either. The people start to die because they can't eat the animals because they're dead. They can't eat the vegetables because they don't grow. It is a famine. Drought and famine synonymous. And now the water's gone. And Elijah's as good as dead at this point. And here's the most interesting part of this to me. If you were watching the brook dry up, what would you pray for? I mean, this is not hard. Rain. A little rain? Maybe just right here? Rain? Elijah's not worshiping the rain god. Why can't he get rain? You would think he would pray for rain. But it's not just that he's not praying for rain. James chapter 5, verse 17 says that Elijah, a man like herself, fervently prayed that it would not rain. So he's watching the brook run dry while he's praying every day and every night that God would not send rain. It was his prayer that was holding back the rain, James says. Do you understand that Elijah valued the word of the Lord more than his own life? So much so he was praying to his own harm, which God answered the prayer, held back the rain, and now there's no water. Now there's no rain in the land, it says. And only then, not a second earlier, but only after the brook had dried up, verse 8, the word of Yahweh came to him. Notice God's word again coming to him anew, afresh, every day, saying, arise, go to Zarephath, This is not even Israel anymore. It belongs to Sidon. It's a different country. He's now exiled from Israel. Stay there. Behold, I've commanded a widow there to provide for you. Now, a widow is not going to be more generous than the raven. I mean, she's dying also. And we're going to find out in a second, she has a boy at home. She has a little kid at home. She has to provide for her son. And now, how is she going to have extra food for this Israelite? If forced to take your chances with the raven or the widow, I would probably choose the raven, actually. But God doesn't give Elijah the choice, sends him to a widow. So he arose, verse 10, went to Zarephath, and when he came to the gate of the city, behold, a widow is gathering sticks. He called to her and said, please get me a little water in the jar that I may drink. Now notice in verse 9, it's Yahweh saying, I commanded the widow to do this, but we're going to see now the widow has no idea of what this command is. She doesn't know what Elijah is talking about. She hasn't heard from the Lord. And so it's fascinating to me that Yahweh says, I commanded her, and what Yahweh means by that is that it's going to happen. God's command and his providence are one and the same here. God says, I commanded her, but she's just going to do it. She doesn't hear the voice of God. She doesn't believe in Yahweh, we're going to see. She has no faith in Yahweh at all, but she's under Yahweh's word. She's under the authority of his word, regardless if she even hears his word. So Elijah comes to her and says, can I have some water? Which is just an outrageous thing to ask for in a drought. Hey, just get me a glass of water, please. 2 ice cubes. I mean, this is outlandish. Who does this? Elijah is who does this. Verse 11, as she was going to get it, which is itself phenomenal, he called to her and said, also, one more thing, please bring me a piece of bread in your hands. I mean, verse 12, she says, are you out of your mind? No, verse 12, she says, as Yahweh your God lives, I have no bread. Notice this language here. As Yahweh your God lives. She recognizes Elijah as an Israelite. They wore their hair differently. Elijah, of course, is dressed like a freak show. You know, he's got a belt on and this leather belt and this tattered robe and this crazy extravagant hair. I mean, he sleeps in juniper. I mean, this guy's out of control. Nevertheless, he probably is not shaving his sideburns, and so he's identified as an Israelite. And so she tells him, a little dig at him, as Yahweh your God lives, there's no rain. I mean, she knows who's to blame for this. Yahweh's the one who's holding back the rain. He's your God, so don't ask me for food, she says. You're the one who supposedly knows Yahweh. She says, as Yahweh your God lives, I have no bread, only a handful of flour, a little handful of flour in the bowl, a little oil in the jar. Behold, I'm gathering a few sticks so that I can go in and prepare for me and my son that we can eat it and die. She says, I'm going to go prepare my last meal, have it with my son, and the two of us are going to starve to death. So no, you can't have any bread. Elijah says to her, do not fear. Go. Do as you've said. Remember what she said, I'm going to go have my last meal and die. Elijah says, go ahead and do that. But first, make me a little bread cake from it and bring it out to me, and afterwards make one for yourself and your son. Implication, and then you can die. You know, I know you just have enough for you and your last meal and then you'll starve to death, but could I have the first slice of that cake? For thus says Yahweh, God of Israel. Notice he owns it. This is my God, Yahweh, the God of Israel. This is what God says. Here's the word of the Lord again. The bowl of flour will not be exhausted, nor shall the jar of oil be empty until the day that Yahweh sends rain on the face of the earth. So she went and did according to the word of Elijah, and she and he and her household, which is her son, ate for many days. So God gives a miracle here. The flour never runs out. The oil never runs out. They always have bread. They're going to continually have sustenance during this famine. Notice the same principle is at work here, though. God only gives enough for the day. I mean, how much do they have left? A handful? Elijah doesn't say God will fill the jar. He doesn't say he will grow it. He just says, you will have enough to live on and it will not disappear. In other words, you will always be one meal away from death, according to the word of God. He won't let it run out, but again, he doesn't give you the Costco membership. You're dependent upon him every day for his word. You know, when I was way before seminary, me and my friends had a Bible memorization challenge. We worked at a mega church in Albuquerque, and we grabbed a pew Bible and we ripped 2 pages out of the Bible and had a contest to see who could memorize their page first. And then we did it again. So there's 2 pew Bibles in the church in Albuquerque that are missing 2 pages each. I apologize for that. But I memorized those 2 pages, the whole thing. Colossians, much of the book of Colossians was one page, and then Hebrews 10, 11, 12, and some of 13 was the other page. I memorized all that many, many years ago. So because of that, I feel like I don't need to memorize the Bible ever again. I have enough. It should last me, right? I should be able to keep on trucking with that memory. I don't even need to have a quiet time anymore because I've stored it up. That's not the way memorization works, is it? That's not the way Bible reading works. You always need to be in the Word. I'm thinking as an Awana parent right now. I know some Awana kids like blast through their book in the first few months. It's done with, boom. Great, I don't need to memorize the Bible again for the rest of the year. And the Awana parents say, no, there's always another book. There's always another verse to memorize. You have to memorize every week. That's the point. You know that's true for you too, not just your kids. You need to be memorizing the Word of God every week. You need to be in the Word of God every day. You need to be dependent upon the Word of the Lord. Don't just feed on Sunday and check back in. It's like manna. The Bible is like manna. God didn't give the Israelites 40 years of manna on their first day in the wilderness. He gave them enough for one day, and he did that every day for 40 years, except on Fridays when he gave them enough for 2 days. That's the principle. Don't live off of what Bible you hear in the church for a week. I mean, that's the opposite of the principle. They didn't have to get manna on Saturday. That's the idea here. You should be in the Word of God on a daily basis because that's how God feeds you. So not only is the Word of the Lord in the world confronting the sinner, the Word of the Lord is also in the world nourishing the saints, encouraging the saints, feeding believers. That's what God's Word does. It feeds us. Well, the third thing God's Word does, it raises the dead. God's Word raises the dead. It's stronger than nature in that it can rebuke the rain and the dew and the ravens and violate natural laws in the face of flour and oil. It's stronger than life in that the widow is going to follow the command of God even at possibly the expense of her own life. And here we're going to see it's stronger than death. God's Word gives life to the dead. Verse 17, it came about after these things that the son of the woman, the mistress of the house, became sick. Now the son this is a little boy. We saw the word that was used earlier in chapter 17, meant it was a little kid. Maybe Elijah's been with her for a year or two. I mean, this kid is probably 8 years old at the most. And the kid becomes sick. His sickness was so severe, there was no breath left in him. That doesn't mean that he was just like flatlined, but he's possibly still alive. This is the Hebrew way of saying he's dead. His soul, literally the Hebrew word nefesh, his soul is gone. The kid is dead. There's no more clear way. It seems ambiguous in English, believe me, in the Hebrew, there is no more clear way to say that somebody died. This is how you would report a death in the Old Testament. His soul is no longer in his body. He's dead, that kind of dead. And the woman carries the boy in her arms and comes to Elijah. And she says to Elijah, "What do I have to do with you, O man of God? You've come to me to bring my iniquity to remembrance and to put my son to death." She yells at Elijah and says, "You are here." She says, "First of all, I want nothing more to do with you. Out of my house. The only reason you came was to remind me of my own sin." Now, the Bible doesn't tell us what sin she's talking about here. We don't know what the sin is, but she has some sin that's dominating her life, that scarred her conscience. She's not a believer in Yahweh. This is separating her from any saving relationship with God at all. She's rejecting God because of this, and she's positive. After years of being fed by a miracle, after years of seeing God's word proved true every single day, her son is dead, and she's reminded of her previous sin. And she takes it out on Elijah. "This is your fault. You did this." It's a logical train wreck. It's a grieving mother, so I'm not going to parse her logic too much, except to say I see this played out all the time in our own world. This is played out with a non-Christian who gets mad at the Christian and says something bad happens in the world, and the non-Christian tells the Christian, "I can't worship your God because your God did this. Your God allows there to be evil in the world. Your God does this or your God does that, so therefore I reject the whole thing." It's a logical train wreck. I mean, here's some questions for the widow. Is God responsible for the death of your son? If yes, then you should worship him, not throw his prophet out of your house. If no, why are you mad at his prophet? If God, either God is in charge or he's not. If he's not in charge, why are you even caring? Why are you yelling at his prophet? If he is in charge, I suggest worshiping the prophet's God. The non-Christian who yells at the Christian and says, I can't worship your God because there's bad things in the world, and your God doesn't stop them, you just ask the question, is my God in charge of the world or not? If he's not, don't yell at me. If he is, try worshiping him instead of yelling at him. It's better that way. Anyway, she hands the boy off to Elijah. Elijah, verse 19, says, give me your son. He took him from her bosom, carried him up to the upper room where he was living, laid him down in his own bed. We're going to see in a second, he lays his body on top of him. He stretches the boy's arms out, puts his arms on top of the boy, his chest on top of the chest, his face on top of the chest. Listen, in the Old Testament, it's not just ravens that were unclean, dead bodies were unclean. No Israelite would ever touch a dead body. There's exceptions in Levitical law. Here's the exceptions. If your parents die, you can touch their body. If your kids die, you can touch their bodies. If your virgin sister dies, you can touch her body. In other words, if your sister is married, you can't touch her body. Her own family can deal with her. But if she's single, then you take her and you touch her and you can bury her. That's it. Here Elijah is taking this boy to his own chest, holding this dead 8-year-old chest to chest. He's taking this boy's death in himself. He's adopting this boy into his own family, so to speak. He's identifying with this boy and saying, this is mine. And he lays him down on his own bed in his own bedroom before the Lord and now is talking to God in prayer. You might even say yelling at God in prayer. He calls the Lord, verse 20, O Lord, O Yahweh, my God, have you also brought calamity to the widow with whom I'm staying by causing her son to die? And don't think he's saying the same thing as the widow. They're opposites here. Both the widow and Yahweh are recognizing that God is, both the widow and Elijah recognize that Yahweh is sovereign over this. Both the widow and the prophet are both saying God is in charge. But the widow is saying, because of that, I want nothing to do with him because I'm a sinner. Elijah is saying, God, because you're in charge, listen to me. One is the response of unbelief. One is the response of faith. They might use the same words even, but they're worlds apart. God, listen to me, he says. Have you brought calamity on this widow with whom I'm saying by causing her son to die? And he stretches himself upon the child 3 times. This is not a mystical incantation here. This is this prophet broken over this kid's death. Again, chest to chest, face to face, arm to arm. He's not following a spell here. He's just grieving and clutching this boy whom he's lived with for years, grabbing his body and weeping and crying out to God. He calls out to Yahweh, verse 21, and said, O Yahweh, my God, I pray to you, let this child's life return to him. Understand, there has never been a resurrection in human history at this point. Nobody else has ever been raised from the dead. Nobody has prayed for it. Nobody has seen it. It's never happened. There's not even a category for this kind of prayer request. And he prays to God 3 times. He's shouting out, let this child's life return to him. Yahweh hears the voice of Elijah. God is sovereign and prayer is effective. Those two aren't enemies, they're not opposites. God is sovereign over prayer. He responds to prayer because he's sovereign over the universe. Yahweh hears the voice of Elijah. The prayer is effective. The prayer ascends to God. The language here is that God hears the prayer and then acts because of it. The life of the child returned to him and he revived. His soul came back to his body. This has never happened before. Elijah picks up the boy, brings him down from the upper room into the house, hands him back to his mother, and Elijah says, see, your son is alive. I mean, Elijah is not the most tender-hearted guy in the scriptures, is he? Here you go, your son's back. The woman said to Elijah, this is the only response possible, now I know that you are a man of God, and the word of Yahweh in your mouth is truth. Notice the first thing she says after she becomes a believer. This is her conversion here. The first thing she says after she places her faith in Yahweh, the very first words out of her mouth is that your word is true. That's what I believe now. God's, the food, the miracles didn't do it. Didn't matter how many times the oil was there, how many times the flour was there. That's not going to change her heart. But now she's seen the dramatic way that the Holy Spirit can bring someone to life, and she is converted and says, God's word is true. It is true. Listen, this child's resurrection is not a picture of Jesus' future resurrection. It's not even a picture of your future resurrection. This child's resurrection is a description of your past resurrection, if you're a believer, that you were dead in your sins and trespasses, that you had no life in and of yourself, you could not make yourself rise in spiritual life, you're born separated from God, the law has broken you, and you're crushed before God, and you cannot make yourself spiritually alive, and then Christ comes and grabs you and holds you to his chest and dies on the cross for your sin, bears the wrath of God that you deserved, he bears it in his own body by clutching you to himself. Jesus is claiming you as his own. And he intercedes for you, and his spirit gives you life, and now you are spiritually alive. This child is a picture of your testimony. You know, the New Testament references this chapter two times. Two times 1 Kings 17 is cited in the New Testament. One, James 5:17, the prayer of a righteous man Elijah, a man like ourselves, prayed that there would be no rain and God withheld the rain. I'll look at that more in a couple weeks as we're gonna see it again. But the second way this passage is used in the New Testament is Jesus' first sermon, Luke chapter 4, he uses it as an illustration of election. He says, he asks the Israelites in the synagogue, he says, is it because there were no widows in Israel that Elijah went to Zarephath? Did he have to leave Israel to find a child to raise from the dead? Is that what was going on? Of course not. God was seeking to save whom he will save. All who come to Christ, he will hold to himself. And he will give life because he came to earth. The Father sent him to earth. Just like God sent Elijah to this widow, the Father sent Christ to the earth. And he comes to the earth, leads a sinless life, and bears God's wrath for our sin, dies on the cross, and now offers salvation to those who would come to Christ, who would place their faith in him, who would look to him. And when you look to him, you see that he's holding you to himself. He's giving you life when you turn your eyes to him. That happens through faith. This is why Jesus calls it the new birth. If that's not your spiritual testimony, I pray that this morning you would give your life to Christ. I pray that you see yourself all over this chapter, that you see yourself as Elijah the prophet using the word of God boldly this week. I pray that you see yourself as the widow dependent upon the Lord's newness of his word every single day. And I pray that you see yourself as this child born spiritually dead but resurrected by the work of the Spirit of Christ in your life. Lord, we're thankful that you save. We're dependent upon your word for food every day, and we come to you because your word has broken us down. Your word was the whip that drove us from our sin and drove us into your arms. We open our eyes and see that you have come to us in love and give us life. We give you thanks for this in Jesus' name. Amen.
You have been listening to Immanuel with Pastor Jesse Johnson. You can find more resources like this at ibcva.com. Here is a parting word from Pastor Jesse.
If you have any questions about what you heard today, or if you want to learn more about what it means to follow Christ, please visit our church website, ibcva.com. If you're not a member of a local church and you live in the Washington, D.C. area, we'd love to have you worship with us here at Immanuel. We're located in Northern Virginia, and for more information about when and where we worship, check out our church website. I hope to personally meet you this Sunday after our service. But no matter where you live, it's our hope that everyone who uses this resource is involved in their own local church. Now may God bless you this week as you seek Jesus constantly, serve the Lord faithfully, and share the gospel boldly.